Josh Gordon getting set to play his first game of the season for the Browns. Mike Pettine and Kyle Shanahan told us about 25 to 30 plays for Gordon today. However, they also added there's no hard, fast pitch count, so we'll keep an eye on just how often Josh Gordon is on the field for Mike Pettine in his first season as Cleveland's head coach. Spent 2002 in Baltimore with Mike Smith. Mike Pettine was a defensive assistant. Mike Smith, the linebackers coach now in his seventh season as head man in Atlanta. The Falcons won the toss. They have elected to receive. So Billy Cundiff will kick it away for the 6-4 Browns. And back deep, one of the best return men in NFL history in Devin Hester for the Falcons. First time in 42 days the Falcons are playing here at the Georgia Dome. Fans have been waiting a while. They played in London. That was considered a home game. That's why they haven't been here since October 12th against the Bears.
Well, this is a big game for both these teams, guys. I mean, this is a game that both Cleveland and Atlanta have to keep pace in their division.
And Hester is going to take this one out. And Jim Leonard wraps him up at the 19-yard line. So out comes Matt Ryan in his seventh year as the Falcons quarterback. First-round pick out of Boston College back in 2008. And he's right now fifth in the NFL in passing yards, closing in on 3,000.
I think we can expect to see a very concerted effort from the Atlanta Falcons, even though they're not one of the top rushing teams in the NFL. In fact, they're 24th in the league. Based on what happened last week to this Cleveland Browns defense, over 211 yards, we can expect Atlanta to try to pound the ball up in there.
Steven Jackson starts at running back for Atlanta. Matt Ryan to the air on first down. Fires, and it's broken up by Buster Screen. Got a hand on that pass intended for Roddy White. Let's take a look at the Falcons starting offense. James Stone, their third different center this year, undrafted out of Tennessee. And Julio Jones is tied for fourth in the NFL with 67 catches.
Yeah, but it's been 44 catches in 7 weeks since Julio Jones found the end zone, and that is unusual for one of the best receivers in the league.
Last touchdown for Jones, week three against Tampa Bay. Give to Jackson on second down across the 20, but not much more than that. It'll bring up third and long for Atlanta as we take a look at the Cleveland defense. And Tabor Rubin had ankle and foot injuries, but he's starting at nose tackle today. As Steve Berline mentioned, Craig Robertson will play the mic for the injured Carlos Dansby. And Joe Hayden had his first interception of the season last week against the Texans.
And we expect to fully see him, he and Julio Jones, locked up most of the day. That's a big challenge for both of those guys.
Third down and 7 for Atlanta. They were 5 out of 15 last week in the win over Carolina. Ryan with time, fires over the middle, and it is caught by Roddy White. It looked like Jim Leonard was just sitting and waiting for that pass, and White cut in front of him to pick up the first down, a gain of 20.
Well, this is great protection up front. It allowed the long route to take advantage of the time that Ryan had. Look at the deep cross. And all the Brown defenders are there, but Roddy White is the only guy that can get to the football. That's why Matt Ryan is going to throw for 4,000 yards again this season.
122nd straight game with a catch for Roddy White. Longest streak in franchise history. It's Jackson again on the ground. And that'll bring up second down. Falcons with a big loss last game, losing Anton Smith, their running back, to a broken leg. Mike Smith told us he's one of the most explosive players we have. So now it'll be Jackson, Jaquez Rogers, and Devontae Freeman carrying the load for Atlanta on the ground.
And it also significantly affects special teams. Anton Smith, one of the best special teams players in the NFL. It's going to take 3 or 4 guys to replace him as his individual player all over the football field.
Ryan looking left, fires left, and it's incomplete. Intended for Julio Jones, and once again, Buster Screen on the coverage for Cleveland.
This looked like a drop to me. Screen gets there, but he gets there a half second after the ball actually bounces off Jones' shoulder pads, and that's rare that the ball gets into his body. It looked like, well, it was a wobbler, but Julio Jones is going to look at himself and say, man, I should have caught that. There's no question. That was just a flat drop. The defender was there. He never touched the football.
So another third and long for Atlanta on this opening drive. Third down and seven.
This is where Cleveland excels, to one of the best in the NFL on third down.
And it's incomplete. Justin Gilbert got a hand on that one. The first round pick, and Kaywan Williams also on coverage for the Browns.
Yeah, Justin Gilbert came in late. I don't think Matt Ryan saw him. I think he thought he had an open lane to the outside, but you see Gilbert flashing in there from the outside. Very well played by the Cleveland Browns, both from the inside and out.
Yeah, you can't do it any better than that. That was great team defense by the Browns.
So Matt Bosher on to punt it away for Atlanta. Leads the NFL in hang time. 4.67 seconds per punt. Nearly blocked. A little contact with the punter. No call. Jim Leonard with a fair catch at the 15-yard line.
I think they're going to say that the rusher was blocked into the punter. That's why there was no roughing the kicker penalty there.
Josh Gordon coming out with the starters. We're back in a moment. First drive for Brian Hoyer and the Browns. Lowest completion percentage in the NFL at 55%, but he is 9-4 as a starter. And Cleveland at 6-4 so far this season. Isaiah Crowell with the first carry, and he is tripped up behind the line for a loss of one. As we take a look at the Cleveland offense, and Mitchell Schwartz had a rough go last week against J.J. Watt, trying to bounce back today, the third-year right tackle. And it is Crowell getting the start at running back. Ben Tate released earlier this week.
And Crowell and Terrence West both shown Mike Pettine and his staff that they can handle the load as the full-time guys.
Josh Gordon, bottom of your screen. Hoyer first the other way to Miles Austin. And that's going to be good for a Cleveland first down. As you take a look at the Atlanta starting defense, Tyson Jackson leveled Cam Newton on the first play of the game last week in Carolina. Paul Warlow, second-year undrafted player out of Delaware, leads the team in tackles. And Robert McLean gets the start at corner.
Yeah, he starts for the injured Robert Alford. And on that first pass play for the Cleveland Browns, they went right after him on the outside to Miles Austin.
Crowell trips. And he loses two on the play. It's a big day for Isaiah Crowell. He grew up in Columbus, Georgia. Spent his freshman year at the University of Georgia. And he's got a lot of family and friends in attendance here at the Georgia Dome.
Well, this Cleveland Browns offense, very dependent on the run game to get everything open in that passing game, especially the play action. But they have been struggling the last 5 weeks. For the last 5 weeks, they have not rushed for more than 70 yards.
Gabriel goes in motion on 2nd and 13, and we have movement and a flag. Today's referee is Brad Allen.
I think the offensive lineman saw one of the defenders jump in.
Neutral zone infraction, number 95, defense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
It was a reaction to the defender who jumped into the neutral zone, and that's a good veteran play by the rookie. Joel Bitonio, the rookie left guard, watch as he sees the defender jump into the neutral zone. And actually, that's Joe Thomas. There's the veteran seven-time Pro Bowler making the savvy move of getting the free 5 yards. After you trip in the backfield and lose two, it's always nice to get a 5-yard penalty. This offensive lineman, they don't get enough credit and they get too much blame. That's a great savvy move. He should get 5 yards rushing for that.
You're right.
Boyer. Looking for Benjamin, makes the catch, but was he in bounds? No, out of bounds, and it will be third down and 8. Curious to see how Cleveland rotates its wide receivers today with the addition of Josh Gordon, who's coming in for this third down and 8 play.
Yeah, they bring in Dre. Actually, I think it's Barnage they bring in off the bench along with Hawkins and Gordon. And I think early in this going, we talked to Kyle Shanahan yesterday, he's interested, and he's also watching his players play, no question, but he's also very interested in what the Atlanta Falcons defensive philosophy is going to be against their personnel combinations.
Josh Gordon in the slot for 3rd and 8. Hoyer looking his way deep down the sideline, broken up. It was Desmond Trufant on the coverage. They tried to take a deep shot with Josh Gordon, but now they'll have to punt.
Well, we talked to Desmond Trufant yesterday to ask him what he was going to do differently against Josh Gordon. He basically said nothing. I'm going to play my technique. I'm going to play my game. I respect him, but I believe that I can handle this task, and we're just going to go out there and play confident, get after it.
So Spencer Lanning, who had an eventful day last Sunday in Cleveland, had that crazy snap where he ran to the left and kicked it with his right foot. Mike Pettine said that was one of the better plays he's ever seen by a punter. So J.J. Watt knocked him twice for two penalties. Hester from the 31. Trying to get to the outside, he does. And Devin Hester out of bounds at the 45-yard line. 10:19 to go. Scoreless in the first quarter between Cleveland and Atlanta.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by Southwest Airlines. Book your low fare now at southwest.com. Pizza Hut. We're taking pizza where it's never been before. And by Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry.
Fourteenth meeting between Cleveland and Atlanta. Their first meeting since 2010 when the Falcons beat the Browns 20-10. 10:19 to go, first quarter, second drive for Matt Ryan and the Falcons. Steven Jackson on first down, trying to spin away from Kitchen and across the 45-yard line down at the 46. Well, it's been a strange year. Matt Ryan called it quirky, as his team is 4-0 against the division and 0-6 against the rest of the NFL.
Well, that's one way to get in first place.
As Ryan said, it's been weird, but hey, we're relevant in November. And in first place in the NFC South, bumps this one all over the middle with Roddy White, who dives forward for a first down. Joe Hayden makes the tackle as Atlanta moves into Cleveland territory.
One of the big factors why this Falcons team, I believe, is heading upward is the O-line now. They have lost five different players up front. They finally had the same offensive line together for the last 3.5 weeks. They're doing a much better job for Matt Ryan now.
They like to run a little tempo here. They give it to Jackson, trying to find some room up the middle. Robertson pushing him back along with Itaba Rubin. Steven Jackson now in his 10th year, 31 years old. He's got 27 straight games without a 100-yard rushing performance.
He's also exactly the kind of back that would give Cleveland some problems now with their decimated front line. I mean, Itaba Rubin and Ismaili Kitchen are in there, but they need big bodies to stop that big back.
Ball Sheard also in on this play. Mike Pettine said he hoped that if he could go, which he is, he'd give 15 to 20 plays today. That one is nearly intercepted by Whitner, and if he did catch that, he would have gone to the house for six.
Just a really, really good job by Whitner setting it up. But Matt Ryan, he'd been around long enough not to make this mistake. That's a fundamental, very easy read. Just a safety jumping the route, following your eyes. Matt Ryan, very, very fortunate that ball was not picked and gone the other way. As you said, Andrew, that would have been an easy 7 points.
That's an enormous missed opportunity by Whitner.
So it's third down and 8 for Atlanta. 1-for-2 on third downs in that opening drive. Inside 9 minutes to go, first quarter. Sheer jumped, and there's the flag. Free play. Ryan gets away. Chased by Bryant, keeps the play alive. Now Ryan fires and incomplete, but again, they're going to get Jabal Sheard for jumping.
Now this is the kind of thing you just can't let happen. You got him in a 3rd and 8, and Sheard trying to jump the snap
offside
to get back.
Defense, number 97, moving into the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
A lot of times when Sheard's not 100%, he injured his foot last week, and when you come out and you're trying to do that, particularly early in the game, you kind of think you have to compensate maybe for the fact that you're not 100%, and on that time, Sheard trying to get an extra little jump cost him a third down.
Mike Pettine told us we were probably going to see Jabal Sheard 15 to 20 snaps, so you got to make the most of those snaps when you're out there.
So 3rd and 8 turns into 3rd and 3 for Atlanta. Ryan, pump fakes. Now he's going to scramble, and he's got the first down. Slides down to 33 right in front of Chris Kirksey, and Atlanta moves the sticks.
And that's the 5-yard penalty that ended up in a third down conversion with this easy scramble by Matt Ryan. Great coverage in the secondary. Julio Jones comes open, but it's way, way late as he spins back to the inside. Matt Ryan's already running for the first down.
Atlanta going no huddle.
Hey, 58, 58, 58. Well, Sunday.
play action. Ryan steps up again in trouble, and Desmond Bryant wraps him up. He did get 2 yards on the play, but early on, you got to give credit to the Cleveland secondary. They've had good coverage downfield.
I was just going to mention that, Andrew. You're right on with it. I mean, they're challenging these receivers for Atlanta. They're not showing any fear or respect, really, when you get down to it. And that's been the thing that Matt Ryan admitted the other day. We have not challenged people up the field yet this year the way we want to. That's got to be a focus if they're going to be up in their face the way they have been to this point.
7th play of this drive for the Falcons. Ryan, and that was another dangerous pass, but it's complete to Roddy White.
You can just see how they're challenging every single throw.
Yeah, and you know what's going to happen. The double move is coming. But why shouldn't the Browns be playing with a lot of confidence? Tashaun Gibson, Buster Screen, Joe Hayden. You know, they've got a bunch of interceptions in this secondary. They're ball hawks. Every team we play, Houston thought so last week, and of course the Falcons think so. They say, man, they're full of ball hawks back there. We've got to be careful. So that's why the Browns got confidence.
Freeman on third down, and he picks up the first, leveled by Fua and Robertson.
Yeah, that was a big boy hit by Robinson there to finish it up. Nice play. I like the play call, pulling all the linemen out front. And Freeman, he finishes it off. But boy, he said, I don't know if I want to take too many more of those the rest of the day today. That was a nice tackle by Robinson. Still a first down.
Freeman's role will increase with the absence of Anton Smith out for the year with that broken leg. Right now it's Steven Jackson in at running back on first and 10.
Safety coming off the backside. Sean Gibson.
Ryan pump fakes, now looking deep for Julio Jones, incomplete. Threw it just a little bit behind him. Joe Hayden on the coverage for the Browns.
Well, a few things happening on this one. You had one-on-one, which is exactly what Matt Ryan saw before the snap, why he checked it. They knew Gibson was coming from the backside, and Cleveland, they told us they want to disguise their coverages better. Matt Ryan figured him out. He just didn't make the throw, and that's kind of what it's come down to this year. When they've had opportunities to make the plays up the field, they have not cashed in. They've got to start making those plays.
Ryan rolls out, now fires, end zone for Jones. Touchdown! His first touchdown since week 3 against Tampa Bay.
Deep crossing route, Joe Hayden in coverage, and Dante Whitner steps up to a shallow cross. Watch Whitner, he's going to move away from it onto Roddy White, and he can't get back in time to cover Julio Jones. Joe Hayden trying to keep Julio Jones from getting up the sideline like we saw one play ago. Gives up the deep cross, hoping for some help inside, and there's just too many guys in there for the safety to cover.
Really nice play design. Great call by the Atlanta Falcons. Dirk Cutter, the offensive coordinator.
Matt Bryant, at 39 years young, nails the extra point, and it's 7-0 Falcons. What could have been for the Browns? Dante Whitner was staring at a pick six, but dropped it. And Matt Ryan makes the Browns pay, connecting with Julio Jones for 6. A 10-play drive for the Falcons. They went 2 for 2 on third downs during that drive. Of course, the ball sheer jumped, which turned a 3rd and 8 into a 3rd and 3. The Falcons converted, and they take a 7-0 lead.
And they actually had stopped him on the 3rd and 8. They had Ryan for a sack. Instead, they got another play at that 3rd and 3 and converted.
Marlon Moore inactive today. He's the normal kick returner, out with an injury. So Taylor Gabriel back deep. And this is a touchback. 5:53 to go, first quarter. Browns trail 7-0.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get DirecTV. And by TD Ameritrade.
The Browns trying to win consecutive games on the road for the first time since 2008. They trail 7-0 here in the first quarter. Terrence West in at running back for Cleveland. Hoyer play action, in trouble, gets rid of it, incomplete. Pressure was coming from Croy Bierman. Let's go back to that touchdown for the Falcons.
Well, you watch Julio Jones at the bottom of the screen. He's going to run a post route, but the key is the safety, Dante Whitner. He gets caught up in the run action, fake this way and bootleg out to the right. He gets caught up. That leaves the middle of the field wide open. What does Matt Ryan do? Let's throw a touchdown pass where Dante Whitner is supposed to be. That's how it works out. It's exactly the way Dirk Cutter wanted that play to come up.
Dante Whitner dropped that interception, and the Falcons put seven on the board. Josh Gordon not in on second down and 10. They pitch it to West, cuts it back inside, and tackled at the 23-yard line. Ball came out late, and Cleveland has it.
This is the play that the Browns run, and you don't see any other team in the league run this. It's a toss inside run, and that ball was fumbled, and Ray Agnew, the third, gets on that for the Browns. They didn't get the advancement of the fumble, which they should have, and Robert McClain making the hit caused the ball to pop out.
First fumble this year for Terrence West, but Agnew saves it. It's third down and 6. Boyer to Gordon, his first catch of the season, and it goes for a first down. Still going up to the 36-yard line. A gain of 12 for number 12. Welcome back, Josh Gordon.
Well, last year in Josh Gordon's first game back after his two-game suspension to open the year, Brian Hoyer targeted him 19 times. He came out of that game with 10 catches, 146 yards, and a touchdown. That's the first ball that they've connected on today. Second target, big for the Browns.
Boyer play action again, throws on the run. That's caught by Hawkins down the sideline into Atlanta territory. And another Cleveland first down, forced out by Josh Wilson.
And this time, the play action once again as Hoyer comes out and Hawkins is all by himself. That's exactly what the offense of the Browns has looked like when it's looked its best.
17-yard gain for Hawkins. This is West. And he is tackled at the 45-yard line.
You know, we've done the Browns a few games, and it's just so fun to watch when they get their run game and the play action working, because Hoyer pulls that ball out, goes back, has all kinds of time, and that really puts pressure on the defensive secondary when the quarterback's standing back there, and they've got all these what used to be really undersized receivers, and now with Josh Gordon, they're big. I mean, all these weapons out in the secondary running free.
On second and 7, West trying to get to the outside, puts his head down, lowers the shoulder, but he's going to get to the 41-yard line, so it will be third down and about 4 for Cleveland.
Well, this is a Falcons defense that really has not defended the run well this year, 24th in the league, but these last couple weeks, I think they've gotten their confidence up. One thing we do know, though, with Kyle Shanahan, as you were saying, Steve, this team is going to stick with the running game as patient as anybody in the NFL, because all of their big plays and play action come off of everybody that plays Kyle Shanahan knows that. Especially Mike Nolan,
Atlanta's defensive coordinator. Third down and 4. They hand it off, and that is going to be a yard short of a first down. It was Isaiah Crowell, the Georgia native, on the carry.
I would almost challenge this. It looked like Crowell got it, and I thought the spots were very, very conservative.
Well, Mike Pettine is keeping the offense on the field.
Yeah, it was not a generous spot at all, Steve, but it looks like they've got almost a full yard to go to get this first down.
Well, you're a team that runs the football against a team that struggles defensively. I applaud the decision.
Cleveland 3-for-11 on fourth downs this year. They play action. Hoyer, pump fakes, in trouble, dumps it down to Agnew. Incomplete, but there's a flag down in the defensive secondary.
Yeah,
back at the 20-yard line.
Kamal Ishmael just tackled Gary Barnidge. The play action fake works. You're going to see when we get to it, it's going to be called on number 36, Kamal Ishmael.
Holding. Defense, number 36. 5-yard penalty, automatic.
And that's one of the things you see so much this year that you never saw so much in years past. The penalties and the points of emphasis, we still continue to see it deep into the season.
Right here, you can see at the bottom of the screen.
Yeah, that's the hold, and that's another penalty that extends a drive. We saw the Cleveland Browns do with Jabal Shibb. Now the Atlanta Falcons have reciprocated with their own penalty to keep the Browns on the field offensively.
So the drive stays alive. Eighth play here with 2:06 to go, first quarter. Quick pass to Gordon, trying to get him in some space, and they do. Nice moves by Gordon down the sideline and knocked out of bounds inside the 10.
I'll tell you, when you have dynamic players like this guy, it makes things so much easier, you know? I mean, Kyle Shanahan said, let's just throw a pass right down the line of scrimmage and let's just see what this guy can do with it. He's so big, but he's so shifty and explosive. Very impressive.
Great block by the fullback, Ray Agnew, on that 22-yard catch by Gordon. They swing it to Benjamin, who dropped the ball. Similar play, different receiver, and it will be second down.
We spoke to Kyle Shanahan yesterday and asked him if he'd asked his dad, Mike Shanahan, the former great head coach, Super Bowl winner, for any advice with Josh Gordon. And he goes, I did not talk to him, but I know what he'd say. You need to get that guy the ball.
Shanahan would see Josh Gordon in the Browns facility these last 10 games, and every day he'd ask him, how many days left until you return? And each day, Josh Gordon knew the exact number of days until he could rejoin his teammates on the practice field. Crowell gets by one, keeps it going, touchdown! The Georgia native scores in Atlanta, and the Browns are an extra point away from tying things up.
Well, just a great job by the Browns. I really like this young guy. We've had a chance to watch him several times this year. You see his confidence growing. He's becoming kind of the featured guy. Watch the one cut right there. And then, boom, he makes, he's so quick and has got such a great feel for where the soft spot is. He makes that one plant and he threw it before you even know what's going on.
Great vision.
Six touchdowns this year, the most by any rookie in the NFL. Missed tackle there by Paul Soliai of the Falcons as Billy Cundiff knocks in the extra point. So Cleveland answers with a big drive. Josh Gordon heavily involved, and Crowell finishes it off. Tied at 7 here at the Georgia Dome.
Watching the NFL on CBS.
1:33 to go, first quarter, and this game is tied at 7. Josh Gordon has been heavily involved for the Browns. 13 of 15 plays, Gordon has already been in there. Remember when we said that they told us it'd be about 25 to 30 plays? Yeah, okay.
That's a little bit of a white lie.
No chance.
How good does he feel right now, being back on the field?
Cundiff kicks it away. Hester is going to take this one out for Atlanta. Away from Mingo, but going the wrong way and stopped inside the 10. Jim Leonard with a special teams tackle. Well, Josh Gordon already heavily involved in the offense for the Cleveland Browns. He started this game and they've gotten to him early and often.
Yeah, they tried to hit him deep just to make a statement on that first drive. They didn't complete it, but the two balls thrown to him since have been significant plays. The kind of impact that Mike Pettine and this Browns team was hoping he would make early in the ball game and continue throughout.
We met with Josh Gordon last night at Cleveland's hotel. He was very focused, seemed very relaxed. No nerves from Josh Gordon. He's just happy to be back out there. A poor field position to start this drive for the Falcons. Ryan in trouble, and Matt Ryan goes down. Very close to the goal line. They're going to mark his forward progress at the 3. Ataba Rubin in on the stop for Cleveland.
Well, this is going to be right over the center. See, just pushing and finally gets all the way back. They're working against Justin Blaylock, who's an 8-year guy. I mean, this is a veteran. He's just bull rushing and finally gets back there. Once again, great coverage, forcing Ryan to pull the ball down.
Not a whole lot of shake and bake there out of 71, right?
That's not a finesse guy right there.
No, just keep pushing. He's going to fall right into your lap.
His first sack of the season, number 12 in Ruben's career. A loss of 6. Ryan on the ground. This is Jaquez Rogers with his first carry today. And he gets close to the 10-yard line. Hayden and Kirksey on the tackle, and that'll bring up third down. Well, only 30 seconds to go in the first quarter.
Yeah, on a third down and 10, or third and 9, you would expect the Falcons to air it out. One of the things you talk about, we talk about how much they throw it. And coming into this game, out of 125 third down plays all season, they only ran the ball 14 times, and 9 of them were on third and short. So they have a huge tendency, no matter what the yardage, to air it out. And certainly they're going to do that on third and 9, but as the game wears on, no matter what yardage is, they're going to sling it.
That's the end of the first quarter with the score tied at 7. We're back to Atlanta after these messages. Started the second quarter in Atlanta alongside the Steves, Tasker and Berlon, and Mike Carey, our officiating expert back in New York. I'm Andrew Catalan. We thank you for joining us. Week 12 of the NFL on CBS, and this quarter begins with 3rd and 9 for the Falcons. Ryan looking deep for Jones, and it is intercepted. Joe Hayden, back-to-back weeks with a pick.
Well, during the break, Steve Tasker and I were talking. I said, I think Atlanta's got to run the ball here, even though all the stats say they're going to throw. Cleveland knows they're going to throw. Everybody's expecting them to throw. They're backed up in their own end zone. I think it was a bad decision to try to throw the football here, especially at Joe Hayden, who's one of the very, very best cover guys in the NFL. Tremendous play by Joe Hayden, second interception on the year.
First time in Matt Ryan's last 90 pass attempts that he has thrown an interception, his 9th of the year.
That was a bad decision, period. Backed up in your own end zone, you cannot make that throw, especially a veteran quarterback like Matt Ryan.
So he gives Cleveland great field position. They'll start at the Atlanta 29-yard line. And now we have a stoppage. Brad Allen in his first year as an NFL referee. Mike Pettin wants to know what's going on.
There is no instant replay review. It will be first down. Please reset the play clock to 25 seconds. Thank you.
Andrew, you know, I'll take it a step further. I think it was a bad decision by Dirk Cutter to call that play backed up in your own end zone. And Dirk Cutter, obviously an aggressive offensive coordinator, wants to push the ball. But I think in that situation, you've got to play situational football.
Terrence West starts this drive at running back for the Browns. In play action to West. Hoyer, good coverage downfield to keep it himself. And he's wrestled out of the 20-yard line. Good decision by Brian Hoyer to step up and run that ball.
Well, they got caught with a fullback out on the outside in Ray Agnew. And once that play came out, Agnew didn't know that he should have broke it up the field.
They're going tempo now without Josh Gordon on the field.
West on 2nd and 1. And with his forward progress, it looks like he'll have a first down. A lot of pressure now on these Cleveland rookie running backs with Terrence West and Isaiah Crowell. As we mentioned earlier, Ben Tate was cut from the team on Tuesday, picked up by Minnesota. He's actually active for the Vikings today, but they're going to run with these rookies the rest of the year. So far, they've shown they're able to handle the load. Hoyer incomplete. Miscommunication there with Gabriel. You guys like the move to let Tate go?
I definitely do. I think it was something needed to be done. Mike Pettin did not blame it on the off-field distractions. Ben Tate, obviously very disgruntled with his role in this offense, was openly complaining. You see the rush for the last 5 games, as we said earlier, not even 70 yards. But this is going to free up these 2 young running backs. And I think it makes a statement to the team as well. If you don't buy in, we don't want you. I think it was a good move by Mike Pettin.
Josh Gordon lined up on the bottom of your screen. Pitch it to West, cuts it back the other way at the 15, spins, and tackled at the 15-yard line. Mike Smith, when we met with him on Friday, made a great point that a lot of times when you see a pitch, you expect a sweep to the outside, but Cleveland likes to cut it back inside. He warned his defense they had to be aware of that today.
Yeah, and with the 3 running backs, or now with the 2 running backs, they seem to specialize those guys, and they let them do what they do best. And I think that's been one of the things that the Cleveland coaching staff has really done well with those young running backs.
Poyer, end zone, incomplete, throwing it in Gordon's direction. And once again, it was Desmond Trufant on the coverage.
This is one of the things where it's going to take a little bit of time, and people maybe understand a little bit the communication, the chemistry between quarterback and receiver. Brian Hoyer, Josh Gordon, not on the same page right there. They didn't instinctively know, based on the way the coverage was being played, where that ball was going to be thrown. And that just takes reps. It takes practice. It takes a little bit of not completing the ball to talk about it and get on the same page.
So now it's a 33-yard field goal attempt for Kundick. He missed from 48 last week, but this one is good. So off the Hayden interception, the Browns answer with a field goal. They lead it 10-7. Brian Hoyer on the left, offensive coordinator Kyle Shanahan on the right. Going over that last drive. Again, Josh Gordon's first time playing in this Kyle Shanahan offense. He told us that he was pretty confident in his grasp of the playbook. There were still a few things he was unsure of, but for the most part, he felt pretty good about it.
And they said they were going to be a little bit careful with him in the up-tempo, the offense they call turbo, those situations, just because when you're executing at that high speed, you got to make sure everybody's on the same page.
Returnable kick for Hester. At the 20, and he's tackled at the 23-yard line. Thanksgiving Day, right next to the turkey and stuffing and pumpkin pie, there's the Bears and the Lions in a Motown throwdown. It all begins with JB, Tony, Bar, Coach, and Boomer on a special holiday edition of the NFL Today at noon Eastern here on CBS Sports. A matchup between Jay Cutler and Matt Stafford of the Lions. All three of us here in the booth have played on Thanksgiving Day. You guys in the NFL, me in my backyard, but I would imagine it's a pretty special thing, though, for you two to play on Thanksgiving.
Right? I bet you had a better day than I did.
On first and 10, Steven Jackson. And he's tackled at the 23.
Yeah, you know, I was fortunate. I played a couple years for the Dallas Cowboys, and every year they have the Thanksgiving Day game. And back in those days, though, that was when Thursday football was, that was the only time of year it was happening. And it was a huge deal and a huge adjustment. The Cowboys had such an advantage because they were the only ones that did it. So we used to love taking advantage of that opportunity.
53! Sunday! Let him go!
Ryan to a wide open Hester. Underthrew it a bit, but at the same time, it's good for an Atlanta first down.
Look at Julio Jones as he comes off. And he runs right into the underneath coverage there as Kirksey's coming out into the flat to cover his area, and Jones whacks right into him. That's one way to take a number one receiver out.
13-yard gain for Devin Hester. It's first and 10. Jackson up the middle across the 40 and down to the 43-yard line. Craig Robertson makes the tackle.
And this is the kind of running that you would expect to see going at the middle of this Cleveland Browns defense. Right up the pipe. That's where Steven Jackson is best at, and that's where the weakness, the soft spot of this Browns defense is.
Incomplete. We go back to New York. Our first update today with JB and Bart Scott.
Blunt paint, immediate dividends.
Yeah, set up by 81-yard Danny Amendola kickoff return. LeGarrette Blunt caps it off with a 3-yard run. LeGarrette Blunt just signed earlier this week, pats up 14-6.
Back to Andrew, Steve. Hey, Steve.
Guys, thanks. LeGarrette Blunt was available, so was Ben Tate after the Browns released him on Tuesday. Third down and 3 for the Falcons. Ryan, feeling the heat, steps up and he goes down. Ball came out. Paul Kruger is saying that the Browns have the football.
It'll depend as the officials go in there. If they see anybody with the ball, they'll start calling possession. And then after that, it won't matter how many times the ball changes hands. And they did.
And they get it.
The Browns came up with it.
Second turnover forced by the Browns. Desmond Bryan comes away from the pile with the football.
Well, Kruger makes a great move
on right tackle, actually it's Asamoah, the guard pops out to grab him. There the ball is out, you can see it on the ground, and then I've told you before, Satan lives on the bottom of an NFL pile, and you don't want any part of that down there. You almost rather jump into a tree grinder.
Excellent play by Paul Kruger. So now Matt Ryan with an interception and a lost fumble. And once again, Cleveland will start a drive in Atlanta territory with 11:15 to go in the first half.
Look for Cleveland to be aggressive with the play calling here.
Play action, Hoyer to Gordon for a first down. And they finally get him to the ground at the 24-yard line. Desmond Trufant with the tackle, but a gain of 16.
A good offensive coordinator like Kyle Shanahan is, when you get a turnover, a big play, you get that field position, a lot of times you want to attack that defense when they're on their heels and having to make the adjustment.
This is the 18th snap for Josh Gordon. They go back his way a little bit high and incomplete.
Oh, that was a missed throw by Hoyer. That play out in front of Gordon was going to be down inside the 10 or 5-yard line. As you watch, he threw that way behind him. That ball's got to be clear out here, and Hoyer just didn't put it on target.
That's a missed opportunity for sure.
Gordon on the sideline, three receiver set for Cleveland on 2nd and 10. Browns practiced inside all week with loud music. Try to get adjusted, bad snap. Hoyer tries to fall on it, and he does. Nick McDonald, the center, and nearly Cleveland coughed it up right back.
I don't think it was a bad snap. I think Brian Hoyer took his eyes off of it. Let's see what happens. It looked to me like it was right in this breadbasket. Yeah, he just started to run a little too early. That's not on the center. It wasn't absolutely perfect, but, I mean, the ball is just off the left side of the number. Brian Hoyer needs to make that play. Now it's 3rd and 14. That's hard to convert in this situation.
Hoyer caught by Austin at the 20, and he is short of a first down. So once again, off a turnover, Cleveland is forced to attempt a field goal.
Atlanta doing a nice job. They got a break with the muff snap. But even so, and the inaccurate pass, I mean, Cleveland's got to be over there looking at themselves going, man, we are, you know, what an opportunity we just blew with an inaccurate pass by Hoyer, a bad snap, and all of a sudden we end up with a field goal on a turnover where our offense is actually clicking very well.
And a great job by the Atlanta defense stepping up both times off the turnover.
37-yard try for Cundiff. And he's now 2 for 2 today, but two turnovers have led to two field goals, just 6 points for the Browns.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by the all-new LG G3, the world's first smartphone with laser autofocus. K Jewelers, every kiss begins with K. And by the all-new 2015 Honda Fit, the new Fit is a great fit for you.
A look at the new College Football Hall of Fame, which opened here in Atlanta last August. Neat stuff, interactive journey into the game that begins when visitors select their favorite college football team, worth checking out. Now, two Cleveland takeaways have led to just 6 points, so 13-7 in favor of the Browns with 9:20 to go in the first half. Hester back deep. And this is a touchback for Billy Cundiff. Atlanta going back out on offense. When we come back, you're watching the NFL on CBS. People affected by severe weather and other disasters need help now. To support those impacted by disasters like the winter storms in Buffalo and countless other crises, text Red Cross to 90999 to give $10 to American Red Cross Disaster Relief. CBS cares. Certainly our thoughts go out to all those in Buffalo. A very dangerous situation, one Steve Tasker knows very well. He still lives in Buffalo, the longtime Buffalo Bill. They pitch it to Devontae Freeman on first down. Trying to get to the outside, breaks the tackle, and a late flag comes in. Freeman was wrapped up right near the first down marker. We'll await the call. rookie out of Florida State.
Holding, offense, number 84, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Wipe that one off, holding against Roddy White.
Well, I thank you for reading the public service announcement about Buffalo. That's 83 and a half inches fell at my house, and they were cooped up for 6 days, and we had actually had it good. There are people, a number of people who've lost their lives in this storm. This is a once-in-a-generation storm that hit that area, and they're still digging out, although the travel bans have been lifted. We really appreciate all the thoughts and prayers that have come in from around the country.
Well said, Steve. And the Bills game moved to Detroit. They'll play the Jets tomorrow night. So following the penalty, first down and 18. Ryan looking for a deep shot to Julio Jones, and it's incomplete. Joe Hayden stride for stride with Julio Jones.
You know, actually, Andrew, I think Julio Jones had a chance. This is the kind of play I was talking to some people before the game. They've had opportunities up the field. You can see a ball over the top to Julio Jones. Instead of outside, he might have a chance to go get that ball. Matt Ryan's got to get that ball out in front of him.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That ball's got to be out into the field. Joe Hayden played that perfectly, but Julio Jones, what a great receiver. When he got a step on Hayden, you see how he cut him off and ran in front of him. That's where Ryan's got to see it and put it, the ball in front, exactly. Not to the side.
Matt Ryan, 5 out of 13, 71 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. They run it. And Freeman out to the 18-yard line. It'll be third down and long. Check that. It was Jaquez Rogers, but it'll be third down and long for the Falcons.
The other thing when you got a receiver like Julio Jones or Josh Gordon on the other side, I believe that you truly have to give them at least two or three opportunities to go up and get a football. Keep it in the field of play. They're huge.
Yeah.
And they got long arms. You go up and let them go up and get that football. They're going to get pass interference or make the catch.
Atlanta 3 out of 6 on third downs in this opening half. It's third and 11. Browns only rushed 3, but Ryan's still out of the pocket. Now fires deep for Roddy White. First down Atlanta. Wrapped up in midfield by Kaywan Williams, but a gain of 32.
Well, super job by Matt Ryan. You know, he's shown a few times today his athletic ability. He's not really a runner at all, but he can buy extra time and extend plays, and he's got a good feel for what's happening all over the field. Super job by Roddy White to come and get back in the vision of Matt Ryan when he was running to his right. That's a huge play, backed up third and long.
That's his first catch of at least 25 yards since week one. It went for 32. Monte Freeman can't get around screen. Good pursuit by the Cleveland rush defense. Desmond Bryant also in there for the Browns.
Yeah, that's a little bit of frustration on the defensive front right there. They thought they were going to get off the field on that third and long, and man, they really attacked the line of scrimmage on that first down. Atlanta trying to do the best they can to be more successful on first down so they can be more successful on third down. They've been third and long way too much already. Really going in this game.
Ryan steps up, can run it, instead dumps it to Steven Jackson, and he's wrapped up in the 44-yard line. Matt Ryan had some room to run, but instead Steven Jackson with his 15th catch of the season.
Well, in general, I think unless you're one of two or three quarterbacks in the NFL, it's better to let these running backs run with the football. Matt Ryan almost got to the line of scrimmage when he made that throw, but good choice to get the ball to Steven Jackson. He's much more effective running the football than Matt Ryan is.
Ryan, 2 for 4 passing on third downs. Faced with third and four here as we approach 6 minutes to go in the second quarter. Miscommunication with Harry Douglas. He wasn't even looking for that one, and now it's fourth down. And Mike Smith is going to send out his punt team.
Yeah, to this point, you know, I'm really a big Matt Ryan fan in general as a quarterback, what he's accomplished at this point in his career, but he has missed a lot of opportunities today to make throws in situations where you expect your franchise quarterback to make the throw.
He started this game just 7 out of 16. Second punt for Bosher, and Jim Leonard awaiting the kick at the 10. Great hang time by Bosher. This one bounces. Can the Falcons keep it? No, it's a touchback, and Cleveland will start at the 20. The Browns lead 13-7. You're watching the NFL on CBS.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by T. Rowe Price. Understanding the connections of a complex global economy, invest with confidence. And by Bud Light, who reminds fans to stay in the game and drink responsibly.
Browns with their fifth drive of this first half. You see their first four possessions. Last two short fields resulted in two field goals. 5:47 to go in the second quarter. And they stopped this play before Wes could get it going. And a false start against the Browns.
False start. Offense, number 81. 5-yard penalty. First down.
It's on Jim Dre. Thursday on CBS, a new discovery could expose the madness behind Sherlock Holmes' methods. Don't miss a surprising new Elementary. Thursday at 10 on Central. Only CBS. Second penalty against the Browns. It makes it first and 15. So far, West with five carries. Correll with four carries.
Hey, 15 long.
Len Winston, the third running back, is active, but expected just to see him on special teams today as West works his way up to the 18-yard line. Bar two on the tackle for the Falcons. Well, last week, Mike Pettine, Kyle Shanahan said they got away from their formula. 24 runs, 50 passes against the Houston Texans. So far today, 12 runs, 13 passes. They're getting back to their formula, which has worked so well.
Well, they just got whiffed up front. One J.J. Watt and the rest of the defensive front for the Texans could not allow them to get that run game going.
Here comes it to West. West gets away from Warley. Stiff arm and forced out of bounds at the 27-yard line. Good run after catch by the rookie Terrence West, who ran into Paul Warlow on that play. Warlow played at Delaware, West at Towson. They used to meet three times in their career back in college.
Yeah, Warlow had to admit, too, West had some success against his Delaware team.
Well, West had big numbers, tied for first in FCS history with 84 rushing touchdowns in his career.
And what did Warlow say? He had a pretty good college career.
Yeah, he did all right.
He did okay.
Third down and three. Hawkins slips a tackle. He's got a first down and some room to run. Hawkins drilled to the 44-yard line. First down for Cleveland.
How can you not love Andrew Hawkins? He's the shortest player in the NFL to actually lead his team in receiving. This guy, what a great runner with he is after the football, after he gets the ball. You know, Mike Smith said, I think this might be the fastest receiving corps in the NFL.
Especially on this turf, West up the middle. And two flags, three flags come in way back behind the play.
This has got to be either illegal substitution or too many men on the field.
12 men on the defense, 5-yard penalty. First down.
Yeah, whenever you see the laundry list come out, I mean, you're going to 16, you know, all six officials threw their flag, and you knew it had to be something, you know, logistic. It had to be, it couldn't be a procedure or anything like that. I mean, all of them are watching different parts of the field. When they all came up with the same flag, that kind of narrows it down as to what it's going to be.
And that shows you how sharp those referees are, too. They get a lot of grief, but you know, they're right more often than they're not. And to be, for all of them to be that sharp and that on top of it is pretty impressive.
Somewhere Mike Carey is smiling at what Steve Berline just had to say. First and five.
I'm not going to say that, I'll tell you.
Inside 4 minutes to go. Crowell trying to cut it back, slips. And he's tackled at midfield. No gain on the play. But this Atlanta defense has really been a problem this year. Last in the NFL in pass yards allowed. Last in the NFL in total yards allowed. And you know, an early theme here, Brian Hoyer's had time to throw the football. Atlanta just 13 sacks on the season, tied for the second fewest in the NFL. Crowell again has the first down for Cleveland.
Well, you talk about that, the sacks, though, and the pass, the porous pass defense, but they've gotten better the last 2 weeks. Six sacks and several turnovers. They're trying to build on that.
Easy. I will.
Josh Gordon on the bottom of your screen on first and 10. Boyer looking his direction instead. Intercepted. Picked off by Ishmael. And he's tackled at the 50-yard line. Third straight game that Kamal Ishmael has an interception.
Well, if you want to improve your defense quickly, get some turnovers. Brian Hoyer just doesn't put enough air under this and can't get it over Ishmael's head. You'll see. He's got Dre open. You see it right up here. All he's got to do is put this ball up ahead of him, and he throws it right to Ishmael. He's got to lob that football up. It's just not enough on it.
Yeah, just a really poor throw. Brian Hoyer is better than that. We've seen it all year. He knows it. He's got to get that ball up and over to the outside.
His sixth interception of the season. Now let's see if the Falcons can take advantage. First and 10 from the 50. Ryan with time over the middle, and he connects with Julio Jones down to the 28. First down, Falcons.
Great protection again for Matt Ryan. You let these big receivers get up the field uncontested. Joe Hayden has been doing a good job contesting Julio Jones most of the day. But right there, free release, big target over the middle, clean pocket for Matt Ryan. That's a recipe for failure for the Cleveland Browns.
Well, Julio Jones leads the NFL in receptions of 20-plus yards, and he's adding to his total. That one went for 21. Ryan in trouble. Steps up. Now throws. Caught by the tight end, Toy Lolo. Good job by Matt Ryan to elude the rush, as that takes us to the two-minute warning. Atlanta on the move. They trail by six. Kamal Ishmael with an interception in his third straight game. Brian Hoyer, the latest victim. Two-minute warning. Each team has all three timeouts remaining. It's second down and two for the Falcons. They have the ball at the 21-yard line. Steven Jackson trying to take a block from his tight end, Toy Lolo, falls forward and has the first down as Atlanta enters the red zone. Saw Brian Cox there, defensive line coach for the Falcons, formerly an assistant with the Browns in 2009 and 2010.
Great linebacker for the Miami Dolphins and New England Patriots back in the day. I know.
Atlanta using a little clock here. They don't want to give Cleveland the ball back with much time left. Browns will start the second half with the football. Ryan fires right, and that's caught by Roddy White. And he goes out of bounds at the 13-yard line.
Well, you talked about Roddy White. We talked to him yesterday, and he told us that, you know, he had a hamstring that he tweaked back in week two early in the season, and it took him a while to get himself back on track. But, boy, these last 3 weeks, he has really turned it on a little bit. You look at that graphic in the red zone.
Yeah, great matchup today. Atlanta fourth in the league red zone offense. Cleveland third in the NFL in red zone defense. 1:15 to go. Ryan, and he throws it toward the end zone, incomplete. He was looking for Devontae Freeman. Good coverage there by the Browns.
And this is a part of the extensive third down package, or passing down package, that Cleveland puts out. You see Paul Kruger peeling off into coverage. Kruger already with a sack and been in Matt Ryan's face all day, so you know Matt Ryan put his pass protection accounting for Kruger to rush, and the Browns cross him up, put Kruger in coverage, and it ends up having two guys out there defending that pass.
I think Matt Ryan also, when he realized what was going on, he liked that possibility of getting a running back on Kruger up the field, just didn't make the play again.
Atlanta needs the 9-yard line for a first down. Ryan fires, caught right at the 9-yard line. Julio Jones makes the catch, and it's first and goal for the Falcons. Time continues to tick. Now inside 1 minute to go, and the Falcons have called their first timeout. We'll be back after these messages. Coming up on the Verizon Halftime Report, join JB, Tony Bart, Boomer, and Coach Cower for all the latest NFL scores, highlights, and first half analysis. It's all coming up on the Verizon Halftime Report. During that timeout, the three of us discussing that timeout by the Falcons, you'd think they'd want to make the Browns use their timeouts and said they use their first. So first and goal from the 8-yard line. Ryan, shovel pass. Rodgers inside the five. And he's in. Touchdown. Jaquez Rodgers. His first receiving touchdown of the season. And off the interception, Atlanta is able to take advantage.
We talk about the loss of Antoine Smith and what that meant to this offense. He's a big play guy, but Matt Ryan said what a luxury to have Jaquez Rodgers and Devontae Freeman as backups, showing their versatility right there. A really nice play call by Dirt Cutter. Little shovel pass inside, run very well by the Atlanta Falcons offense.
19th touchdown pass this season for Matt Ryan, and now Matt Bryant on for the extra point. And he gives Atlanta the lead, 14-13.
But to your point, Andrew, I mean, I really believe that the Falcons helped the Cleveland Browns by taking a timeout there. Should not have happened. Now they got 55 seconds on the clock and timeouts left.
Yeah, we'll see if the Browns can take advantage of it, but I agree. There's no way there should be 55 seconds left in the first half with the Atlanta Falcons doing what they did. They should have let that clock run all the way down, because then you put it back in the court of the Browns, said they've got to start using theirs.
Or at least, yeah, you make them use one of their timeouts.
Right.
Exactly.
Week 12 continues later today on CBS and for some of you on Fox. And tonight, Sunday Night Football on NBC. And tune in tomorrow for Monday Night Football on ESPN. Plus, Monday night, the Jets and Bills face off in Detroit. Check your local listings and you'll see Steve Tasker patrolling the sidelines in that game on CBS. Tasker, a man on the move these days. It's everywhere.
Well, I can't go home.
Unfortunately for me, I can't get to my house, so
might as well work.
I'm working.
So Cleveland with all three timeouts, and it's Benjamin back deep. It was Gabriel back deep earlier in this first half for the Browns. Again, Marlon Moore inactive today because of an injury. Benjamin will let this go. So Cleveland will get the ball at the 20. 55 seconds on the clock for Brian Hoyer.
Well, the difference is to this point in the game, Cleveland off the two turnovers they generated, they come away with two field goals. Atlanta on the other side of the field, they get the turnover on the last drive. They cash it in for a touchdown. Have the one-point lead now.
Yeah, I think your philosophy here isn't field goal or touchdown, Tresker. What you're trying to do right now, if the Cleveland Browns get off to a good start,
right,
give yourself a chance, and then work with it as you get to the other end of the field with what you can do, whether touchdown, field goal, field position, clock management.
Right. A lot of teams start with a draw or a screen on the first play.
Browns have not scored any points in two-minute situations this year. Looking deep for Josh Gordon, and that one was thrown out of bounds. Hoyer missed wide left.
Well, Desmond Trufant was running down the sideline. He read the pass correctly. I thought he misread it because Josh Gordon's running down the middle of the field there. He's, you know, inside more. Trufant saw the ball coming more outside. I don't think Josh Gordon ever found that ball.
Boyer now 8 for 17 passing in the first half. Gordon, 3 catches, 51 yards, but he's been targeted 7 times. Swing it to Gordon. Again, trying to get him in some space. Following his blocks, Josh Gordon. First down for Cleveland. All the way up to the 38-yard line.
Well, there's a screen pass we were talking about. They didn't do it on first down, but they did it on second. Easy completion to a playmaker. Seemed to get the ball.
Cleveland did not call timeout here. They have all three. Now inside 30 seconds to go. Hoyer takes the snap over the middle to Austin. Incomplete. Curious move not to use a timeout there by the Browns.
Yeah, that was a long pass play. You got to come all the way to the line of scrimmage, get lined up. It just took too much time. Now, they did get this clock stoppage here with the incomplete pass, but still, I mean, we're talking you know, valuable seconds. But I think both teams have misused their timeouts here in the last couple of minutes.
Billy Cundiff's career long is 56 yards. Certainly helps kicking indoors here in Atlanta. 23 seconds remain. Hoyer, Hawkins at the 45, slips a tackle, stays in bounds, still going, now gets out of bounds. Andrew Hawkins getting it done after the catch.
Wow.
Great job fighting for the extra yards. Well, and now they have three timeouts left, only 14 seconds on the clock. Super job getting out of bounds, though.
But still, Cleveland has all three timeouts, and they're 14 seconds left. They're not going to have time to use all three.
Exactly.
It does give them the luxury of throwing the football to the middle of the field here.
But they would have still had that had they used a timeout.
No question.
Earlier.
First and 10. Even Nora bringing pressure. Hoyer finds Hawkins again. Running the wrong way. Tackle at the 42. Cleveland calls a quick timeout. 8 seconds remain.
Yeah, they've got time with the timeout left.
It's got to be a quick throw and timeout.
They have two timeouts left. And don't forget, coming up on the Verizon Halftime Report, JB, Tony, Bart, Boomer, and Coach Cower have all the latest NFL scores, highlights, and first half analysis. It's all coming up on the Verizon Halftime Report. From here, it would be about a 60-yard field goal for Cundiff. That 56-yarder that we showed you was his career high. That was back in 2005.
But well, I will tell you this, Andrew. Billy Cundiff in his career is only 8 of 27 from 50-plus. That's the worst in the NFL.
29% in his career from 50 and beyond. Second down and 5. Looking for Gordon, incomplete. Again, these two do not seem to be on the same page.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, though. Gordon was wide open. I mean, that was a completion, and if
exactly.
he catches that in stride, in space, it's tough to tackle him.
Right behind him.
Yet another opportunity here in the first half that the Browns have not taken advantage of.
They've got a hit on that.
But that's what you expect. As we get lined up for a 60-yard field goal, you expect that though with a guy coming in after such a long break.
So Cleveland is going to go into the locker room with two timeouts remaining. Meanwhile, Devin Hester is waiting underneath the upright. He's taken one back before. 60-yard attempt, and they stop it before the kick. It was well short right into Hester's arms, but a timeout was called.
Charge timeout. Atlanta. They're second.
That's the last timeout. That's another blown timeout. What? I mean, that's an enormous opportunity for Devin. I mean, he still got the opportunity, but now the Browns know that
he's back.
Cundiff's got no shot at making this 60-yarder. They might change it up and try and go Hail Mary or something like that, or punt it.
Well, I wouldn't punt it. I would throw a Hail Mary.
Exactly. You can't. I mean, they're going to let him kick it again. You got to tell, you got offensive linemen covering this kick.
It was clock mismanagement to put them in this situation in the first place, though. I think you got to start there. But
well, he was a few yards short in that previous one, blown dead. Cundiff from 60. And that one is wide right now. Watch out for Hester. He's going to take it out. Hester at the 15, down the sideline. Devin Hester at midfield. And he is tackled from behind. That was Joel Bitonio, the rookie left guard, who may have saved the touchdown. Excellent play by the rookie. Hester sold that one. And we all knew it was coming. And Hester still almost took it the distance. Look at Bitonio right there. It's halftime. Atlanta leads 14-13. entertaining first half in Atlanta, where the Falcons have a 14-13 lead on the Browns. Back in the booth with the Steves, Berline and Tasker, I'm Andrew Catalan. Big question coming in, how much would we see Josh Gordon? The Browns told us between 25 and 30 plays. He played 23 plays in the first half, and a mixed bag for Josh Gordon.
Yeah, so I guess we won't see him at all the second half, maybe. You know, they threw the ball to him. They tried to find ways to create it to him on the short passes. They went up the field a few times. He's shown the explosive ability that we know he has. The rhythm between he and Hoyer has not been there, the chemistry, and that's what you would kind of expect in these type of situations with not that many reps together.
Yeah, I think another thing is that they've gotten a feel for how Atlanta has decided to play the Browns offense, and they've left Josh Gordon uncovered. As we saw in some of those highlights, the Browns have just missed those opportunities. Look for Hoyer to start spreading the football around. Also, obviously, they want to still keep Gordon in the game, but there's also some other guys on this field that in Josh Gordon's absence, Miles Austin and all of those guys are going to spread their wings, and they've proven they can play.
And not a great first half by Matt Ryan either. You know, he completed 8 of 12 after his interception, so it seems like he's got his rhythm going now. But he missed some opportunities early in this ball game to really make some big plays up the field. They expect him and need him to play like that in the second half.
The Browns get the football to start the second half. Matt Bosher, one of five punters in the NFL who also handle kickoff duties. Taylor Gabriel back deep, and it will be a touchback. The Browns will start at the 20. Let's take a look at what your second half adjustments are, Steves.
Well, from my standpoint, I think you look at Cleveland, they got to get the running game going. If they get running the football, that gets them in the rhythm that they want to have. That's when this offense is at its most efficient. They really haven't had the rhythm today. In order to get it, you got to commit and make the run game work.
Yeah, for me, I think they still need to throw this football to win. Matt Ryan has done some nice things, not only the pocket, but getting outside the pocket to make some plays. And I think if they want to do that, and if Ryan can keep plays alive, they'll hit the Browns for some big plays.
They start this half, play action, pressure coming. Hoyer keeps it going, fires to Gordon, who makes the catch and knocked out of bounds at the 25-yard line by Paul Warlow.
It's a great job by Hoyer. What a lot of poise. They've got good pressure. The Falcons are finally getting the feel for that bootleg as you see McClain jump in the air, coming up into getting Hoyer's face. Great job by Hoyer keeping his poise. But slowly but surely, this defense is catching up to this offense.
Gain of 5, second and 5. The pitch to Crowell with a little bit of room. Puts his head down and picks up the first down for the Browns. As we take a look at some of the first half numbers, turnover certainly a big story. And Atlanta made the most of that one Cleveland turnover, turning it into 7 points, while the Falcons turned it over twice, and all the Browns could manage was 2 field goals.
Yep, not overly impressive either way. Both teams, I think, start to show signs of life late in that first half.
Terrence West. And he gets to the 34-yard line. Tackle made by Tyson Jackson in his first year with the Falcons. Look at the numbers for Hoyer. 12 out of 23 right now, 156 yards, but only 4 different receivers. Gordon, Hawkins, Austin, and West. So you haven't really heard from Benjamin or Gabriel, guys that made a big part of what made this Cleveland offense go the first 10 weeks of the season. No catches for the tight ends either. Of course, Jordan Cameron missing his 4th straight game. However, he did practice on a limited basis Friday. Mike Pettine hopes to have him back next week. Oh, they botch this one. Ball is out. Gordon scoops it up, and he throws it, and he throws it away. That's actually an excellent play by Josh Gordon.
Really, really good play.
Yeah, that shouldn't be a penalty. He threw it right over Brian Hoyer's head, which is a really sharp play. You're right. That's a heads-up, smart play. Get out of a catastrophe by just taking the incompletion. You see, that's going from bad to worse and then saving it by Gordon. That's a sharp play.
I think that was a called play. They were going to, because there were no linemen down the field, they were going to have Gordon throw that football. Great presence to realize, hey, I can throw it away. The pocket was broken.
So it's 3rd down and 6. Hoyer over the middle, and it's caught for a first down. Hawkins has some speed at the 30, and Hawkins still keeping the legs going. And finally, forward progress stopped at the 25, but a gain of 39 for the speedy Andrew Hawkins.
Well, we spoke about just as we came back after halftime that Hoyer might start spreading the football around. These guys have proven in Josh Gordon's absence that they can carry the load. Hawkins, of course, a big play threat. So quick and so difficult to guard inside, snapping open for his fifth catch of the day.
Ryan Hoyer has not thrown a touchdown pass in his last 100 attempts. However, he's got the Browns on the move here, and he's going back to the air. This is caught by the tight end. That's Barnage. And he's tackled at the 18-yard line. But again, you have to go back to that play by Josh Gordon. That would have been a 15, 20-yard loss at least. And then if he tried to run it, and instead he throws it away. Excellent job by the third-year man out of Baylor. Gordon lined up at the top of your screen. It's second down and three. Crowell up the middle. First down, and he's inside the 10. First and goal for the Cleveland Browns.
Here he is again, Crowell. How good he is at pushing this ball to the front side, pressing the hole on the front side, and then making that cutback when the defense over pursues. One cut up inside, big game.
Josh Gordon now lined up bottom of your screen. First and goal for Cleveland. Crowell to the five. They love that hashtag in Cleveland, feed the crow. And they're feeding Crowell right now. The Georgia native already with one rushing touchdown. And he's got nine carries for 37 yards.
We've talked about the release of Ben Tate this week, and I think the club wouldn't have felt comfortable doing that had these two young receivers, Crowell and West, proven themselves over the first 2.5 months of the season. Now the coaching staff, the players, they know they can handle it, and they can take a step forward with their roster by releasing Tate and helping their special teams at the other end of the roster.
Ninth play of the drive. Hoyer, end zone broken up. He was looking for Miles Austin and Robert McClain, who's starting for the injured Robert Alford, got a hand on that one.
Well, Miles Austin had two significant drop passes last week against the Houston Texans. Let's see if he got a hand on this one or not. There was no hand on that ball. It's tight down there in the red zone. It's hard. There's a lot of traffic. But when you get a chance to make the catch, you got to pull that ball in.
Third and goal. Hoyer, pump fakes, in trouble, and he's sacked. Thrown down by Croy Bierman. And once again, this Falcons defense forces the Browns to attempt a field goal.
I think this was a little bit of a mix-up. Brian Hoyer was looking at Josh Gordon, and I don't know whether Josh didn't do what he was expecting him to do, or... Well, it was this great defense, one or the other, but Hoyer was definitely looking that way, held it too long. Bierman makes him pay.
Yeah, the Falcons did a nice job passing the receiver off, and the inside receiver came out. I think he flashed in front of Hoyer's intention, and Hoyer didn't want to throw it.
Cundiff already with two made field goals today, make it three. This one from 32 yards, but once again, the Falcons defense forcing three. Croy Bierman now with 2.5 sacks on the season. A big one here on third down. Back in Atlanta, a long drive for the Browns. It covered 11 plays and more than 5 minutes on the clock. However, it results in the third Billy Cundiff field goal of the day. We've had three lead changes today, and the Browns now back in front 16-14. Devin Hester had a little excitement at the end of that first half. Joel Bitonio may have saved a touchdown. And Hester back deep to receive this kick from Cundiff. Bounces at the five. Hester will take it out. And he's chopped down at the 17-yard line. 16-14, the Browns in front.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by Southwest Airlines. Book your low fare now at southwest.com. See Ellis. And by Kelly Blue Book. Find out what you should pay for your next new car at KBB.com.
Back at the Georgia Dome with the Steves, Berline, and Tasker. I'm Andrew Catalan. We thank you for joining us. Week 12 of the NFL on CBS. 9:41 to go, third quarter. Falcons with the ball. They trail by two. Ryan will start this drive in the air. Looking deep for Julio Jones. Incomplete. Once again, Joe Hayden matched up with Julio Jones and had good coverage on that play.
Yeah, you're right, Andrew. This was great coverage by Joe Hayden. This time Matt Ryan got the ball out in front of Julio Jones. He can't quite make the catch, but that would have had to have been an absolutely perfect throw.
Yeah, we talked to Joe Hayden. He said this is going to be just like back in college. Hayden, of course, Florida, and Julio Jones at Alabama. He said they went against each other a few times and was looking forward to challenging him again.
Steven Jackson gets the call on second and 10 across the 20 and all the way up to the 23-yard line. It'll be third and short for the Falcons. Well, you can get the fastest football scores and updates with the CBS Sports app. It's the fastest app for sports fans. Just download the CBS Sports app today. Falcons 5 of 9 on third downs in the first half. And they're faced with a third and 5 here. And they will huddle up.
And this is a Cleveland defense that is one of the best in the league on third down. Number 8 coming into this game. So that's been that's quite a success for the Falcons at this point.
Ryan has time. Over the middle. Caught by Hester for a first down. Good patience by Ryan. Went through his progressions and finds Hester to move the chains.
You know what I like about what this offense is doing in spreading the ball around and getting Devin Hester the ball? You know, everywhere Devin Hester's been prior to this, he was never really looked at as a receiver, as part of the offensive package. He was a weapon, but they couldn't find ways to get the ball to him. This year, coming into this game, he had 22 catches. And today, he's got two more, so he's got almost 25. He's got 24 catches on the year.
Did not play a single down at wide receiver last year for the Bears. Jackson and Robertson comes up to make that tackle. Greg Robertson playing the Mike linebacker position today for the injured Carlos Dansby. We sat with him last night. As you see, Dansby there did make the trip but not able to go. And Robertson said that since day one of OTAs and training camp, the Browns staff prepared him to play the Mike position. And with Dansby a little older in age, taking a few plays off during training camp, Robertson had plenty of reps, felt very comfortable sliding over to play the Mike today. Ryan all day. Now gets rid of it to Jackson.
Woo! Nice job, Jack.
He's up to the 38-yard line. Billy Wynn makes the tackle for the Browns.
Yeah, that's Matt Ryan doing a nice job. He ended up with just a three-man rush, realized it, took plenty of time, let the deep routes develop, and then just was very happy to take the check down to Jackson and get up into a third and three. It's a perfect job by a veteran quarterback. Made it look really easy, even though Cleveland defended the play pretty well.
Third and three. In trouble, gets away from Kruger. Kruger gets back up, and Kruger with the sack. What a play by Paul Kruger.
Well, I don't know what Matt Ryan thought, but when Kruger went by him the first time, he was almost like a deer running right back in front of the car. Watch Kruger go by him, miss his jersey. Ryan runs right back at him. Kruger gets up and sacks him.
Yeah, that was not a good decision by Matt Ryan to give Paul Kruger a second chance at him.
His team leading seventh sack of the season for Kruger, and now Bosher will punt it away, but a flag comes in and a false start against the Falcons.
False start. Offense, number 41. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
That's on the rookie Desmond Southward. third-round pick out of Wisconsin. So that'll back Bosher up. Travis Benjamin, who earlier this week, special teams coach Chris Tabor said that Benjamin's got a little bit of his swagger back on punt return. Lost the job for a few weeks, but he's back at the 29-yard line. And this one comes off the side of Bosher's foot, a knuckleball. Does take a Falcons bounce out of bounds at the 30. It goes for 47, not the prettiest for Bosher. Cleveland's ball when we come back. Andrew Hawkins and Josh Gordon tied for the team lead with five catches apiece. Gordon, 75 yards receiving, and this is first game of the season after missing the first 10 because of a suspension for failing a drug test. Cleveland will start this drive at the 30, and they started on the ground with West. And West gets a couple of yards. Such a weird contrast in terms of the division standings. Cleveland at 6-4, yet in last place in the AFC North. Meanwhile, Mike Smith at 4-6, and in first place in the NFC South. 4-0 against the division, 0-6 against the rest of the NFL for the Atlanta Falcons.
Well, as Mike Smith told us, it's just a matter of getting to that second season, and whatever it takes, they control their own destiny.
West again, and Hageman makes the tackle at the 35-yard line. It will be third down and short for Cleveland. Well, one thing that Atlanta started doing was focusing on going 1-0 each week, and obviously that's a cliche, but this Falcons team has taken it a step further. T-shirts appeared in all their lockers on Friday that said 1-0 on it, and they're really buying into this mantra of 1-0. Right now, they're looking at a 3rd-and-5 defensively with 4.5 minutes to go in the third quarter. Hoyer over the middle, and it's caught for a first down by Miles Austin. His first catch. Make that his third catch today for Austin.
A credit the offensive line for the Browns. Nice pocket for Brian Hoyer to step up and throw. And this is a tough catch by Miles Austin. No one coming across the middle. He's going to be probably running into a headache. That was Ishmael that was there waiting for him, but a nice tough catch. Good throw by Brian Hoyer as well.
And again, a lack of pressure from Atlanta's front seven. They just have given Hoyer plenty of time to throw to. Hoyer steps up, will keep it himself, and slides into Atlanta territory at the 49-yard line.
Well, this Browns offense, we've seen them so much go tempo and go no huddle. I think one of the things they're not doing today is doing that no huddle. I think they've shortened the game up. We're deep into the third quarter already, and Brian Hoyer and company in no hurry to get these plays off. They have used it at times, but as you see there, they're getting back to their formula. 21 rush, 29 pass. It was so out of whack last week.
Twice as many passes as runs a week ago in the loss to Houston. Here's West with a first down. Tackled at the 40-yard line by Ishmael. But Terrence West, the third-round pick out of Towson, having a big game today for the Browns.
You talked about that inside pitch that Cleveland runs, Steve, but Mike Smith was saying the problem is they do the outside toss as well, and if you don't pursue to the outside, they'll make you hurt there.
Hoyer, quick drop, fires and out to Gordon, who's got it at the 31. We go back to New York, an update with JB and Bart Scott.
Talk about a celebration.
I tell you what, welcome to the club, the new papa, T.Y. Hilton. Ties his career-long 73 yards. He said he was going to score one for his baby. T.Y. Hilton, 3 for 114. Wonder what he's going to name her.
He might name a touchdown for all we know. Back to Andrew, Steve, and Steve.
Oh, you gotta love that. Love the celebration by Hilton. 2:10 to go, third quarter. As you see the AFC South standings. Colts at 6-4, undefeated in the division. West has the first down for the Browns.
Yeah, this is where it gets to the point, and we've seen it before with this Brown team, and this Atlanta team's getting a dose of it today. Once the Browns' running game starts to get going,
you're going to get a belly full. That Atlanta front four is going to get sick to death of tackling those running backs. They won't do anything else.
We talked about how they need to get that running game going. They've already rushed in the second half for what they had in the first half.
West dragged down by Jonathan Babineau. What a fast-moving quarter this has been.
Yeah, one of the things you talk about it, Steve, when you're on the sidelines as a team and the Atlanta Falcons offense standing over there, you just feel defenseless when you can't stop the run. It feels like you can do nothing positive because it's the other team just pushing you out of the way and taking what they want. It's really demoralizing as a defense and an offense when your opponent can run the football this effectively.
Keeping it on the ground with Crowell. Cuts it back the other way. Crowell with some room at the 15. Crowell still going. Stays on his feet. And he's in. Touchdown. What a run by the rookie Isaiah Crowell. A 26-yard score.
And that's that unique inside toss. Again, the defense sees toss. They want to run to the sideline because they think it's a sweep. And watch how quick Crowell cuts this thing back inside. It's almost like a design cutback run. You'll see as he catches it, everybody starts pursuing for the sweep, and all of a sudden there's nobody backside. And in the rest, he just does by himself.
There's an injured Falcon down on the play. That's Robert McLean down at the 15. We'll come right back after this.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by Taco Bell. The new way to Taco Bell is here, only in the app. And by Miller Lite. Back in its original look, it's Miller time.
Robert McLean, the corner, being attended to on the Falcons sideline. Meanwhile, it's the second rushing touchdown today for Isaiah Crowell, back in his home state, grew up in Columbus, Georgia, about an hour and a half drive from here, as Billy Cundiff is now on for the extra point. This would make it a two-possession game, and he does, 23-14. A 26-yard touchdown run, the longest touchdown run of Isaiah Crowell's career. A nine-play, 70-yard drive for Brian Hoyer, and the Browns capped off by the nifty 26-yard touchdown run from Isaiah Crowell. And that's one of the reasons why Cleveland felt confident that it could let go of Ben Tate, as they did earlier this week. 46 seconds remain in the third quarter. And Hester will make it a touchback. Tomorrow on CBS, there's a mole inside NCIS Los Angeles, and no one is safe. A can't-miss new NCIS Los Angeles, tomorrow at 10, 9 Central, only CBS. So Matt Ryan back out onto the field. He's 14 out of 25 for 177 yards, two touchdowns, and one interception. Steven Jackson starts this drive, and he gets 3 yards on the play. Tackle made by Kirksey. Atlanta's had a tough time coming from behind this year. Look at the second half numbers for Matt Ryan this season.
Yeah, and I think a little bit of that, and Steve, you can say this as a quarterback. I put a little bit on the coaching staff. You need some adjustments that give you more chances to be successful. You shouldn't be less successful.
I agree. I think second half adjustments are key.
Ryan? Diving attempt by Toy Lolo falls incomplete.
And on that note, I mean, it does translate, especially should translate into the performance of a veteran quarterback. That's a very significant difference in performance from the first half to the second half. That means defenses are coming out and making the proper adjustments, and you're not offensively.
Yeah, and I, you can say what you want about Matt Ryan, but if you're completing 70% of your passes in the first half, something's wrong if you're coming out after halftime and having that lack of success with the same guys on the field. I mean, it makes no sense.
Third down and six. Ryan fires, caught, first down. And that is Devin Hester. Ball ripped out late. But they're saying he was down. First down for the Falcons, and that will be the final play of the third quarter. Atlanta with just 30 yards in that third quarter. They trail by nine. We're back to Atlanta after this message and a word from your local station. Start of the fourth quarter at the Georgia Dome, and the hometown Falcons trail 23-14. With the Steves, Berline, and Tasker, I'm Andrew Catalan, our entire CBS crew here in Atlanta. The Falcons, after the first down catch by Hester, begin this quarter on the ground with Rogers. Not much doing. Desmond Bryant makes the tackle. See, Matt Ryan did not have many opportunities in that third quarter. Trying to lead the Falcons, and they're going a little no huddle here. Browns making some substitutions. And now they'll let Matt Ryan snap the football. Brown showing blitz. Here comes Whitner. Leonard also coming. Ryan gets a look at the Roddy White. And Roddy White pushed out of bounds by the rookie Justin Gilbert. Browns brought pressure off both sides. Ryan stepped up and made the throw.
Nice job by Matt Ryan. Seeing the pressure. Jim Leonard coming off the top of your screen right there, unblocked. Matt Ryan knew it. Had to get rid of that ball hot. Took the hit and had a nice pickup on the completion.
Yeah, Ryan made that play before the snap because of him changing the call and getting the protection right and recognizing the blitz.
Not enough for a first down. It's third and three. Falcons are 7 out of 12 on third downs today. They go with four wide receivers. Here comes Mingo. Ryan gets away to Douglas for a first down. Forced out of bounds by Williams, but Barkevious Mingo applying the pressure, and once again, Matt Ryan stepped up and delivered.
Barkevious Mingo, they've been waiting for him to make a splash pass rush-wise. Here he is coming right off the edge there. He beats the left tackle, Jake Matthews. Matt Ryan, though, steps up, keeps his composure. A very, very nice job finding his check down, converting it.
Eagle! Great listening to Matt Ryan as Freeman gets away from Wynn. The rest of the Browns defense waiting for Freeman. Craig Robertson, the first one to get there. Whitner made the hit as well.
Yeah, you can see it's become a common word when you hear Matt Ryan say, easy, easy. That means don't go. I'm changing the play or the snap count or something. I see something, and all the linemen, everybody's ears perk up because when he says that, they know a change is coming.
Out route to Roddy White, right at the sticks, shoved out of bounds by Buster Screen.
A nice job by Roddy White on the route. Buster Screen playing soft coverage, but Matt Ryan identifies a single coverage, throws a nice catchable ball to the outside, and another conversion first down for the Atlanta Falcons.
Roddy White started taking cooking classes this week, said he's tired of eating out. So he tweeted a photo of himself in an apron, learning how to get some food for himself. Roddy White, Devontae Freeman up in the middle. We asked him about it, and he said, when I'm on the field, I want to have a wrestler's mentality. He's a two-time high school state champion in wrestling. When I'm at home, I want to have my mom's mentality in the kitchen. He was very proud of his pineapple rice this week.
I'd give it a shot. Maybe.
Second down and four. Ryan to Toilolo. First down, cuts back, and he's tripped up. Robertson touches him at the 20. And a first down for the Falcons.
Toilolo, had he been able to keep his feet, he had more room to run up the sidelines. Dante Whitner just got a piece of him right there. You can see he had green grass in front of him. Would have been another 5-6 yards minimum.
Hey, send him. There you
go. Ryan back to the air. Fires end zone. Incomplete, flag down. He threw that one into double coverage. And a couple of the Browns are still down on the ground. That's Joe Hayden.
Yeah, Sean Gibson and Hayden are both down. They crashed in, converging on that pass.
Holding. Defense, number 23.
5-yard penalty, automatic, touchdown.
And both Hayden and Gibson still down on the ground.
Oh, that was a very, very dangerous throw by Matt Ryan. He had Roddy White singled up top. But you see right here, Julio Jones, Joe Hayden coming underneath.
Hayden, I don't just know where the penalty was. One hand, his right hand looked like, right, that was before that. He grabbed a handful of jersey just for a split second, and the official called it.
Both players still down. We're back after.
We're watching the NFL on CBS.
Back in Atlanta, the good news for Cleveland is that Joe Hayden was able to walk off under his own power, but Tashaun Gibson is still in a lot of pain for the Browns, the NFL's leader in interceptions with 6 on the season. And as we documented earlier, Cleveland's just been ravaged by injuries defensively. Carlos Dansby not playing today. Sheard has been banged up.
This has not looked good for Gibson. We can't speculate on what it is, but they tried to help him off, and he couldn't continue off. And here he collides with Hayden, and it appears to be his right knee.
And as Steve Tasker said, Gibson started hobbling off and then went down to the ground, and now they're bringing cart out for Tashaun Gibson.
And you don't know. I mean, maybe he got up and was feeling woozy and dizzy. Maybe there was a leg injury as well as a head injury as well. We don't know. He's grabbing the leg right away. See that, yeah. He did try to walk him out the field, as Steve Tasker said during the break, but he had to sit right back down.
Yeah, he asked him to stop. And Joe Hayden, you can see the look on Joe Hayden's face. He was just sick to look out there and see his teammate and friend and the guy who's led this defense in the secondary, leading the NFL with interceptions, as you said. I mean, what a huge loss this would be if Gibson turns out to have a significant injury.
And if you're the Browns or you're a Browns fan, you're thinking, how many more times are we going to see our guys go down? Alex Mack, Jordan Cameron, Hughes has been out, Armonte Bryant, Phil Taylor, the list goes on and on for Browns. And yes, you can keep saying man up, next man up, but after a while you're like, when is this going
to
end?
When it gets to the point where next man up wasn't on your team 2 weeks ago, you're in dire straits. And that's what the Browns are going to be looking at. If this goes further, the Browns are going to be really having to sign players.
And as Mike Pettine pointed out, I thought he made a great point earlier this week, this time of year, it's very difficult to find players. You're late in the season.
If they're not on a roster somewhere, I mean, they're probably not on a roster for a reason. And you got to look practice squads. You're trying to find bodies anywhere you possibly can. Hard job, hard thing to come up with.
So Tashaun Gibson will go off in a cart. And you can tell he is certainly in a lot of pain for the Browns. Clock stop with 11:20 to go, fourth quarter.
Well, on the play where Gibson was hurt, Joe Hayden was called for a pass holding, and here's the penalty. It's not going to be much.
If you're a defender, Cleveland fan, you're going to be upset.
Yeah, watch the number 11 on the back of Julio Jones' jersey. Watch as he grabs him, and watch it snap just right there. That's all it was. Just a small tug on the jersey, and the flag was thrown.
Officials said if they see the jersey tugged at all, they're going to throw the flag.
So Hayden cannot be in for this play. Has to sit at least one out. They pitch it to Jaquez Rogers, and not much doing on that. And Joe Hayden immediately runs back out onto the field. So good sign for the Browns. He's okay. By rule, if the clock is stopped because of an injury, a player has to sit out for at least one play unless that team calls a timeout. So a good sign for Hayden as Justin Gilbert goes back to the bench. It's second down and 8. And Jim Leonard has taken the spot of Tashaun Gibson. Right. To Julio Jones down to the 6-yard line. And that's good for an Atlanta first down. It's first and goal.
Atlanta immediately sees Joe Hayden come back into the game. They decide they want to test him. Julio Jones just ran a simple hook route. Had a nice, clean, free release again, and big conversion there.
And you saw there Jim Leonard into the game for Tashaun Gibson. Leonard, 10-year veteran, very wily, very smart. He'll line up and decide, not the same physical gifts, but certainly an experienced safety.
13th play of the drive. Ryan fires to White, and he's down to the line. Roddy White quickly wrapped up by Buster Screen. It's second and goal.
Great coverage by Buster Screen, an even better catch by Roddy White. And a great tackle by Buster Screen, I mean, but good, tough catch on the move by Roddy White trying to stick it in the end zone, but a nice tackle.
And I can, you know, right now, you're going to see Steven Jackson try and score right here, you can bet.
They do give it to Jackson, and he gets in. Touchdown, Falcons. Fifth rushing touchdown this season for the 31-year-old vet.
Well, nothing special. You called it out, Steve Tasker, just straight up the gut. Good job right there pulling around the corner. Was John Asamoah, and that's what gave Steven Jackson the impetus to get into that end zone. That was a drive the Atlanta Falcons had to answer to start off this fourth quarter. They needed a touchdown to get within striking distance.
That was big boy short yardage play right there.
So now Matt Bryant on for the extra point with 9:31 to go, and we've got a two-point game at the Georgia Dome. Steven Jackson caps off the long drive for the Falcons. You're watching the NFL on CBS.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by Verizon XLTE on America's largest, most reliable 4G LTE network. Game of War. Play free now. And by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
We've got a good one in the Georgia Dome with 9:31 to go. The Browns lead 23-21. 14-play, 80-yard drive by the Falcons on offense, just what the doctor ordered. And now their defense has had some time to rest up for this big possession coming up for the Browns. Gabriel back deep. Mosher kicks it away. And that will be a touchback. Cleveland will start at the 20. When we come back, a two-point Cleveland lead. Tomorrow on CBS, are two broke girls ready for a business seminar? And is it ready for them? An all-new Two Broke Girls, followed by The Big Bang Theory. Tomorrow at 8, 7 Central, only CBS. It's been 42 days since the Falcons have played a game here at the Georgia Dome. The crowd loud with 9:31 to go. Play action. Hoyer holds on to it. Now gets rid of it to Crowell. Tackle immediately made by Paul Warlow. Meanwhile, injury update to Sean Gibson will not return for the Browns, out with a knee injury. And a late flag has been thrown in the holding. Atlanta secondary.
Defense, number 21. 5-yard penalty. Automatic. First down.
That's on Desmond Trufant.
Desmond Trufant getting matched up with Gordon one-on-one. You can see there he's looking at him. And he grabs the face mask right there and then grabs him again and down the field. That's the hold right there. You can't put yourself in front and then latch on to the receiver. I think Josh Gordon did a good job running kind of right at him and kind of forcing the issue.
Gordon's got about 35 pounds on Trufant. Crowell across the 30, and a late flag comes in from behind Brian Hoyer.
Holding, offense, number 81, 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's on the tight end, Jim Dre.
And that's that cutback toss the other way this time. You're going to see right at the bottom of your screen right here, that's Jim Dre. The play is cutting back behind him. That's a hole. You see the arms get outside the framework of the body. He's pulling them down. That was Malachi Goodman.
Again, Jordan Cameron out, his fourth straight game. Still feeling effects of a concussion. Did practice on Friday, though. First and 20. Hoyer to Austin. And he lunges up to the 25-yard line. Good play on first and long for the Browns. Bartu makes the tackle.
He got the penalty yardage back. Austin been a little bit quiet today. We saw him just miss the opportunity in the end zone, but then answer it with a reception later. But Austin, I think, is one of the guys that I think the Browns need to give more opportunities to. He's a big receiver, and he's got a lot of experience as well. But no question, all those Browns receivers need to pitch in. It's not going to be about Josh Gordon for the rest of the season.
Crowell gets the outside and gets the first down, but another flag is down right at the 38-yard line.
This is way away from the play. I can't imagine what the call was and how it impacted the play on the backside of a sweep.
Browns are indicating it's going against Atlanta.
Illegal use of the hands by hands to the face, number 93 defense. 5-yard penalty is added to the end of the play. Automatic first down.
Malachi Goodman, the guilty party.
Well, right here, Goodman's going to get his hand up into the phaser. You saw the hold, and that's it right there. Knocked his helmet off and then slapped it back on as though to cover his tracks.
Well, that's a good job by that back referee way back there, 20 yards down the field. Saw that through the flag.
Meanwhile, Crowell now has a career high with 80 yards rushing today to go along with the two touchdowns. Josh Gordon makes the catch at the 45, and he plows over Trufant. That's the physical toughness that Josh Gordon brings at wide receiver. Another first down, a gain of 12.
The big receivers will do that once in a while. They'll drop that shoulder and finish the run hard right up the sideline. And the next time, they'll give him a little jab step and go around him. That's a great job by Gordon getting the extra yards. But you can bet Trufant's going to think about that next time he has to make the tackle.
They got Desmond Trufant listed at 6 foot and Josh Gordon at 6'3". I think they're wrong both ways. Gordon's bigger, Trufant smaller.
West to the 39. When we spoke with Kyle Shanahan, the Browns offensive coordinator last night, he spent some time in Houston in his career, and he said that Gordon reminds him of Andre Johnson. And we asked Josh Gordon, who are your favorite receivers that you like to watch? And he said, Randy Moss and Andre Johnson. I love big physical guys, and he's playing that way, that's for sure. Gordon with 7 catches for 96 yards in his 2014 debut. Meanwhile, clock continues to tick. 6.5 to go in the fourth quarter.
Now this Falcons defense has to step up.
Hoyer, and that's caught by Gabriel, his first catch today. And it's good for another Cleveland first down.
Well, this is really disconcerting for a defense. Gabriel's been nowhere all day, and all of a sudden on a critical down, they go right to him. When you have more weapons, it becomes harder to defend. And at this point of the game, when Atlanta feels like they're getting a handle on it, Cleveland finds yet another guy to throw the football to.
Hoyer hustles his team to the line, yet using up the play clock. Smart move here inside, 6 minutes to go. They keep it on the ground with West. Bounces it outside. West with some room to run. Terrence West still going inside the 10 and down to the 6. A gain of 20 for the rookie Terrence West.
Now this is a play that was designed to go up inside. You see West cutting it back. He runs into his own lineman, the big pileup, and then the Falcons defense converges. He's got the presence and the ability to pop it back outside, take it down the edge, and finish off a big run, putting him down at the 6-yard line.
Browns have rushed for 109 yards in this half. And you look at the red zone offense. They've had 3 field goals today. Gordon up top of your screen. Play action. Hoyer rolls right, looking to throw it back for Gordon, and it's intercepted by Trufant. What a killer mistake by Brian Hoyer. Picked off in the end zone.
I don't know if I'd put this on Hoyer. I like the idea. Josh Gordon gave up on the throw. He didn't try and go up and get it. He watched it go over his head and just watched the defender come down with it. And that is a great interception by Trufant. Josh Gordon's got to make an effort at least to keep that from being completed.
The NFL on CBS is sponsored by Voya Financial, changing the way you think of retirement. And by Subway Restaurants. Get your own big hot pastrami melt at Subway.
The interception has been confirmed. First and 10 for the Falcons at the 20-yard line. Ryan in trouble and just throws it away. Let's go back to that interception, and we have a great angle of Trufant getting both feet down.
Yeah, his right foot comes down first, and then the left foot, knee, shin area right there, that foot's in. No doubt an interception. Steve, I'm going to dispute what you were saying. Not disagree, I guess. I think it was a careless throw by Hoyer. You had first and goal at the 6-yard line. Josh Ward, no doubt, should have made a better effort to make that break up that interception, but that ball should not have been thrown. It was good coverage by Trufant. First and goal at the 6, too dangerous a throw.
Second interception today by Brian Hoyer. Ryan looking right, throws right, caught by Devin Hester, and that's an Atlanta first down. Gain of 13.
And we've seen this a couple of times. Buster Screen is going to give a big cushion without safety help, or I'm sorry, Gilbert gives a big cushion with no safety help in the back. They've got to honor the deep route, and when they snap it off and it's a good throw like that, they're going to take that all day.
Each team with all three timeouts remaining. Ryan looking deep for Julio Jones, matched up with Hayden, incomplete. That's been a great battle today between those two Pro Bowlers.
And this, I like what Matt Ryan does here. He gives it a jump ball opportunity to the big wide receiver on the outside. Julio Jones goes up and almost comes down with that ball. That's one, if you take another step, maybe he can go up and get that football. Good effort. Great coverage again by Joe Hayden.
It's just so fun to see two guys who are really among the elite guys at their position go one-on-one.
Just compete.
Yeah, that's why this is a great game.
Hayden, four tackles, one pick, and one pass defense. Second and 10. Ryan hit as he throws, and it's somehow caught by Roddy White. Williams drilled Matt Ryan, and he still got it away to Roddy White.
This is a clean shot, a free-running rusher. Watch, right there, 36, boom, right into the rib cage, and lets up on him. Oh, look at that. You can tell he felt that one, and he delivers the football. Roddy White helping his quarterback out. Wow.
Big-time play
both
right in there.
Both ends of that play.
No doubt.
What a year it's been for the undrafted rookie, Kaywan Williams. Made a huge impact for the Browns this season. 4 minutes to go. Third down and 5. Ryan feeling the heat again. Intercepted. It's dropped. Oh, Buster Screen had it in his hands. And again, it was Kaywan Williams applying the pressure on Matt Ryan.
Go ahead, Steve.
Julio Jones saves the interception, just turning around and runs right into the front of Screen. Watch this, and he hits it, catches it, and then knocks it away. Heads up. Tremendous play by Julio Jones, and Matt Ryan taking another shot back in the pocket right here as Williams. Boom. Identical to the last play.
Yeah, Jim O'Neill said, hey, we're going to bring the heat these last two plays, and they got good, clean runs at Matt Ryan. It pays off for him. Almost a huge interception.
Some of the fans booed. They wanted the Falcons to go for it on 4th and 5. Keep in mind, Falcons do have all three timeouts remaining. Can they get a defensive stop? Leonard with the fair catch at the 15. 3:37 to go. The Browns trying to hold on. They lead by 2. Thursday Night Football returns in 2 weeks. Tony Romo and the Cowboys take on the Bears as two of the NFL's greatest franchises meet in primetime. Thursday Night Football returns Thursday, December 4th at 8 p.m. Eastern live on NFL Network. Brian Hoyer has thrown two interceptions today, one on the last drive in the end zone, trying to protect a two-point lead and get the Browns to 7-4 on the season. Each team with all three timeouts remaining. Crowell. And some room up the middle. What a day for Crowell, just 21 years old, out of Columbus, Georgia.
You know, watch as they're going to, once again, run this play, stretch play, one cut right up the field, two hands on the football. Crowell doing the right thing. He knows right now the most important thing for the Browns is to end every play with the ball in their possession.
Coming up after the game, time permitting, the NFL Today update presented by LGG3. Join JB, Tony, Bark, Boomer, and Coach Cower for all the latest NFL scores and highlights. A career-high 88 yards rushing by Isaiah Crowell. 21 running backs were drafted, none named Crowell, and a flag comes in.
False start. Offense, number 75. Five-yard penalty. Second down.
It's on the rookie left guard, Joel Bitonio.
That's a huge penalty for Cleveland. You were looking at second and three and in control of the down and distance. Now you're now back to second and eight. And you're going to see Bitonio, left guard. Several guys just stood up. Hoyer was going to try and change the play. And several of his offensive linemen came out of their stance. You can't do that once it's set.
Two on the play clock. Play action. Hoyer over the middle. Sails incomplete. And Dwight Lowry nearly picked that one off for the Falcons.
Barnage went up to try and grab this over the middle. He tips it up dangerously high. And anytime that gets tipped in the secondary, nothing good happens for the offense. But the Browns trying to go with that play action now with a third and seven. Huge, huge down.
The Cleveland 4 of 9 on third down today. This is the biggest of all.
Hoyer looking deep and another miscommunication. Picked off. His third interception of the day. Desmond Southward with his first career INT. Once again, Hoyer was trying to get it to Josh Gordon. Those two have had some good moments today, but there's been a few bad ones as well, and that one is costly.
Well, there's no business throwing this football in this situation unless you're going to give it only a chance for your player to get the football. This ball should have been on the sideline. And if he's throwing it anywhere up the field right there, sure, it works as a punt, a short punt in that situation. But the bottom line is that's a careless throw by Brian Hoyer in that situation. Two times here in the second half, late in the game, he's given the opportunity to the Atlanta Falcons to go down and win this ball game.
Hoyer has tied a career high with three interceptions. The Falcons will start this drive at their own 45-yard line, all three timeouts. Steven Jackson, nowhere to go. Gets away from Kruger, and he's spun down at the 45. No gain on the play.
Now, if you're Atlanta, you still got all your timeouts. You got the two-minute warning, and all you need is a field goal. So there is no reason to be
They need to kick a field goal with 4 seconds left on the clock. I mean, they do not want to use their timeouts. Leave that to the Cleveland Browns if they need to. But this is the Cleveland Browns need to keep them from getting 20 yards in field position to allow them to try the field goal.
Took a lot of time there. Matt Ryan throws to Jones into Cleveland territory. Down at the 46-yard line. It'll be third and one when we come back. Two-minute warning in Atlanta. The Falcons have an excellent kicker in Matt Bryan. His career-long 62 yards as two game winners this season, including last week against Carolina. On third and one, Jackson has the first down for the Falcons. Craig Robertson makes the tackle. Now, Atlanta would love to keep the clock moving. If you're Cleveland, when do you start calling timeouts?
Well, you got to start thinking about it right now. Obviously, you can't afford to let them run off 40 seconds each time.
And I don't know why the Falcons are going no huddle. They should go ahead and let it run down.
Ryan gets rid of it. It's juggled, yet caught by Rodgers. Clock continues to move. And again, I think if you're Mike Pettine, you have to think about trying to save at least some time for one final drive.
Yeah, it's second down right now. I would have liked to have seen a timeout right there. You get a stop here, you get a stop on third down.
You got to use a full play clock as well if you're Atlanta.
Sunday!
They're not. Ryan takes the snap, fires right, caught by Douglas. Tackle made by Williams. It will be third down.
Now Mike Smith takes a timeout.
Atlanta has called a timeout with 55 seconds left. Now, if you're just joining us, There was a lot of questionable timeouts to close the first half. Clock management was an issue for both teams. And again, this is very strange as to why Mike Smith calls a timeout and Mike Pettine has not.
That play what took them right to the field goal range, their 52-yarder right there, which is reasonable to think that you're going to make that field goal. So I don't know why you stop the clock and don't just run the football a couple of times, try and get it closer.
Force Cleveland to
use their timeouts.
Yeah, it's hard to understand the logic here. You are in field goal range, so you want to get it 5 or 6 or 10 yards closer, no doubt about that. But you're not in a position where you want to stop the clock.
Third down and 2. Ryan looking deep down the sideline, and it's broken up. Justin Gilbert on the coverage. Ryan was looking for Devin Hester, and now it's 4th and 2. As Arthur Blank, the Falcons owner, looks on, and Mike Smith does not hesitate. He's going to send out his kicker, Matt Bryant.
I mean, he must have a lot of confidence in Matt Bryant for good reason. He's made 14 of his last 18 from over 50 yards, but I would have, 2, 3, 5 yards in that situation makes a big difference mentally for a kicker. This is a 53-yarder.
This season, Bryant is 4 out of 6 from 50 and beyond. This from 53 to give the Falcons the lead. The kick is on the way, and it's good! With 44 seconds to go, Matt Bryant has done it again!
And you've given Cleveland now, though, at least a chance to get themselves in field goal range. All their timeouts, 44 seconds left. Big time kick by Matt Bryant. Great protection, super execution, but you got to question the clock management.
Bryant is 39 years old in his 13th season in the NFL, and he has been money for this Falcons team. Arthur Blank, yeah, it's good. But Cleveland has all 3 timeouts remaining. Can Brian Hoyer lead the Browns into field goal range?
Well, the crushing interceptions that Brian Hoyer made, you combine that with the fact that off their 2 opportunities with turnovers, the Browns settled for 2 field goals. Those, I think, are the things you look at that really jump out at you as being the difference in this ball game right now.
Benjamin is back deep. Bosher's kick, a low one, and it will be a touchback. Cleveland will start at the 20. It's been a rough day for Brian Hoyer, 19 of 34, and he's tied a career high with 3 interceptions.
Well, he can make up for it all right here. You know, they've been known to come back and win these nail biters. They've done it several times. I guarantee you, every person in that Cleveland Browns huddle believes Brian Hoyer can lead this team down the field for a field goal.
They need a minimum of 45 yards to get to the 35-yard line of the Falcons. They got to do it with 3 timeouts and 44 seconds.
And they got to deal with the crowd noise as well. 1st and 10. Hoyer hit as he throws. Incomplete. Good pressure by the Falcons.
One of the things that's not out of the question here is you see this replay. Hoyer's going to try and get rid of it right from behind. He gets hit, but right now, I'd look, if I'm Cleveland, I think you need to throw the football short and hope for a long run, because they're backing so much into deep coverage. The underneath throws are there, and you've got the small, quick wide receivers who can run after the catch. I think you need to go that direction.
Here's Josh Gordon right here.
7 catches today for Gordon. Hoyer throws the other way, and coming back to make the catch is Miles Austin, and that's good for a first down. Now, they have 3 timeouts, and Cleveland has called its first.
Well, they came with a corner blitz. Miles Austin and Brian Hoyer both saw it. Fortunately, made the completion. Hoyer took a big shot in the backfield right there as he's letting go of the ball. Two guys got there. That was Warlow and Wilson both hitting him at the same time.
Now, keep in mind, Billy Cundiff, in his career from 50 yards and beyond, is 8 out of 27. That 29% is the worst in NFL history.
What that translates to is they need to get to the 30-yard line of Atlanta to have a realistic shot of winning this football game.
Bierman coming with pressure. Hoyer eludes it. Throws on the run. Caught by Gordon. In Atlanta territory. Up to the 45-yard line. And Mike Pettine calls his second timeout.
This is why Atlanta should not have stopped the clock when they had the field goal at the other end. This exact scenario with three timeouts, Cleveland gives himself a chance.
And why they shouldn't have thrown a deep ball on the third down. Run the ball up the middle, pick up a couple more yards, maybe get the first down. It's third and two. You at least make Cleveland have to burn a timeout at that point.
And the way Cleveland has played this second half offensively, they have controlled it. Two bad throws, and I kind of came to Hoyer's defense on the first bad one in the end zone. The second one was a bad throw that ended up in interceptions, and that's the difference.
Josh Gordon in his season debut, 8 catches, 120 yards, his 9th career 100-yard game. Browns have one timeout remaining. Over the middle, caught by the tight end. Burnage still going to the 30 and dragged down with 16 seconds to go. Mike Pettine has called his final timeout. And from there, it would be a 48-yard field goal for Billy Cundiff.
Now, why did Mike Pettine call his last timeout there? You could have spiked it on first down, ran the football once or twice, and then took the timeout when there's 4 seconds left to give yourself an easy shot. The way they're running the football, now the running game is back in the mix with 16 seconds left.
Right now,
they can take a run play, snap off 10 yards. I think there's no way you take the timeout there.
No timeouts left for Mike Pettine and the Browns. They trail by one. 16 seconds remain.
They have to throw the ball here.
Over the middle to Austin at the 20. Now the Browns have to hustle up to the line. No timeouts remaining. 7 seconds to go. And Hoyer spikes it with 5 seconds left on the clock.
And that is brilliant, brilliant by Brian Hoyer. The way that he did it, he's been in this situation as poor as he played prior to this drive with some of those shaky decisions. He does not let it affect him. Mike Pettine got to be extremely happy with how this worked out. And they did get away with some mistakes, in our opinion, clock management-wise.
Great awareness by the Browns to get to that line quickly. They spiked the ball with 5 seconds to go. Cundiff missed from 38 last week. This is from 37 yards. He has 9 career game-winning field goals. Three interceptions, but on the final drive, he gets his team down the field, into field goal range, and Billy Cundiff knocks it through. The Browns win it 26-24.
We've said it about this Browns team, as you see Cundiff's winning kick. They're a team, you know you've got a pretty good football team when you can win on days when you don't play your best. No way the Browns can look at themselves and say they made the best of all their opportunities today, but they come out with a win.
And we both feel that Mike Smith, Atlanta Falcons head coach, made a mistake leaving that much time on the clock for Cleveland to get themselves back down into field goal position and eventually win the game.
On that last drive, Brian Hoyer, 4 out of 7 for 61 yards. And Mike Pettine all fired up as the Browns win consecutive road games for the first time since 2008. Meanwhile, the Falcons now 0-7 against teams outside their division this year. Billy Cundiff, the hero, with that game-winning kick. His fourth field goal today.
And there you see Brian Hoyer. You can't say enough about this guy. You gotta call it like it is. He made some very poor decisions late in that ball game, but he stepped up when the team needed him to, and he's done it time and time again this year. You gotta love his ability to do that at the key points in the game.
Yeah, he was all over the map, good and bad, and it ended up being on the positive side of the ledger for Brian Hoyer in this offense. Their running game reemerged in the second half of this game, really took it over. And without the two Brian Hoyer interceptions, the Browns would be sitting in the driver's seat easily at the end of this game.
Cincinnati wins. Cleveland keeps pace. They're now 7-4. Final score, Cleveland 26, Atlanta 24. For Steve Tasker, Steve Berline, this is Andrew Catalan saying so long from Atlanta. Coming up, the NFL Today update presented by LGG3.